Today, I will explain how the conditional distribution task is computed. The task conditional distribution is this task here. It can be run after the estimation of the population parameters. The goal is to estimate the individual conditional distributions for the individual parameters and sample for each individual sets of parameter values from these distributions. Let's first recall what the conditional distribution is. After running SAEM, we have estimated a population distribution for each parameter. For example, here the volume of distribution V. This distribution is defined by the typical value V pop and the standard deviation of the random effect omega V. It represents the range of values individuals from this population can have. It characterizes the population as a whole. We can also look at the individuals of the dataset individually and estimate their individual volume value. The volume for an individual is described by a conditional distribution like this one, for example, for the volume for the individual 1. It represents the uncertainty of the volume for ID1, taking into account the information available for this individual, the observed data for ID1, the covariate values for ID1, and the fact that the volume for ID1 belongs to the population distribution. It is called conditional distribution because it is conditional on the already estimated population parameters. Each individual has a different conditional distribution. Here are 8 distributions that represent the volumes for 8 different individuals. The conditional distribution is a probability distribution. This means that for individual 8, for example, its volume value is probably around 36, but there is also a small chance that it is rather 45, for instance. The conditional modes, or EBEs, are found with a dedicated task which searches the maximum of the conditional distribution. They represent the most probable values of the individual volumes. But it is also interesting to estimate the whole distributions, not only the peaks, to have an idea of their uncertainties. This is what is done in the task conditional distribution. These distributions cannot usually be computed in closed form, unless we have a linear Gaussian model, so it is not possible to directly calculate the probability for a given parameter. But it is possible to obtain samples from the distributions using a Markov chain Monte Carlo procedure. Note that the feature of the week video number 6 explains in more details how the sampled parameters are then used in monoliths to circumvent the phenomenon of shrinkage. The videos number 79 and 80 are also interesting since they show how these parameters are also used to provide informative statistical tests. In the present video, I will now focus on the conditional distribution task itself, and I will explain how it samples individual parameters to estimate the conditional distributions. The task conditional distribution uses one of the possible Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithms called the Metropolis Hastings algorithm. It is an iterative algorithm used to simulate a sequence of individual parameters like this. At each iteration L, for all individuals, a new vector of random effect values is drawn from some proposal distribution. These random effects correspond to new individual parameters psi. The new parameters are accepted with a probability that depends on the probabilities of the parameters in the population distribution and the likelihood of the individual data given these parameters at this iteration and at the previous iteration. If alpha is above 1, so this combined probability is higher than at the previous iteration, the new draw is kept. If alpha is below 1, the new draw is kept only with probability alpha. This acceptance probability is also called acceptance ratio, and it guarantees that the sequence of parameters converges in distribution to the conditional distributions. For the proposal distribution, monoliths uses 3 different proposal distributions sequentially. These proposal distributions are also called kernels and can be seen in the project settings in the section called transition kernels. By default, at each iteration, Monolith samples new parameters from them with a 2-2-2 pattern. This pattern can be changed in the settings. The first distribution is the population distribution for the random effects, so the normal distribution with mean 0 and standard deviation omega, the estimated variance covariance matrix for the random effects. The second is a unidimensional Gaussian random walk, so each random effect drawn at the previous iteration is perturbed with a random variable drawn from the normal distribution. The third is a multidimensional Gaussian random walk. This time, the vector of random effects drawn at the previous iteration for a random subset of parameters is perturbed with a Gaussian vector. For the random walks, in kernel 2 and 3, the variance of the Gaussian random variables is adjusted at each iteration to reach an optimal acceptance ratio. By default, it is 0.3 and can also be changed in the project settings. This 2-to-2 pattern means that at each iteration, 6 parameters are drawn iteratively from these 3 distributions. So a candidate value is drawn from kernel 1 and is accepted or rejected according to the acceptance rate alpha. Then another candidate is again drawn from kernel 1, and the acceptance ratio is now used with the previous candidate as reference if it had been accepted. Then a candidate value is drawn from kernel 2 and accepted or rejected, and so on. At the end of the sequence, only the last accepted value out of the 6 is kept in the Markov chain for this iteration. This strategy with a sequence of different proposal distributions makes the Markov chain more robust. Note that these settings are in project settings because they are also used for the Markov chain Monte Carlo in SAEM. Let's now see how this procedure looks like. For simplicity, this schema focuses on estimating the conditional distribution of the parameter V for the individual 1. This arrow represents the new value for the volume of ID 1 drawn at the first iteration. This value is accepted or not following the acceptance probability that depends on the change in the probabilities of V1 and its ability to explain the data between this iteration and the last. For the first iteration, the reference is the value of V1 estimated by SAEM. So the distribution of this combined probability is the information that guides the algorithm, and it is represented here as a dashed curve. Remember that this step actually corresponds to several draws for V1, as several transition kernels are selected in the project settings, and 6 draws by default that iteratively improve the candidate based on the acceptance ratio. If the value is rejected, a new value is drawn until a candidate is accepted based on this probability. Then, at the second iteration, the reference used in the acceptance rate is now the value accepted at the first iteration. The next iterations follow the same procedure. The accepted values cover the whole distribution because the acceptance rate allows enough flexibility to accept some values like this one that may be far from the peak. So after a transition period, the algorithm reaches a stationary state where the accepted values follow the conditional distribution, and together they represent an estimation of the distribution. The algorithm ends according to a stopping rule implemented in monolith that decides when convergence is satisfactory. I will explain in a moment what the stopping criteria is. But before, let's have a further look at the results of the algorithm. First, the conditional mean and standard deviation are calculated for each individual by averaging over the values drawn at all iterations. They are a way to summarize the distribution, which has no explicit formula. In particular, the mean that we can call vmean is outputted by monoliths in the interface and the result folder. Since the procedure is actually done on all individuals, monoliths calculates also the average of the conditional means over all individuals and the standard deviations of the conditional means over all individuals. The stopping criteria is based on this estimate and ends the algorithm when these values are stable enough. On this slide, this animation shows the parameters drawn to estimate the conditional distributions for the volume V of 8 individuals. They are grouped as stacked histograms and can be compared to the population distribution in black. The dashed vertical lines are the estimates of the individual conditional means, and the black dashed vertical line is the average of the conditional means, also written here with the standard deviation of the means. These plots show how these values evolve over the iterations. When Monolix runs the task conditional distribution, the same plots can be seen for each parameter in the pop-up window. Monolix adds two red segments on each plot to check the convergence of the estimation. They turn green when the convergence is reached. The segments represent the interval composed of the last 50 iterations as set in the settings of the task in interval length. The width between the two segments represents the deviation defined by relative interval width, by default 5%, around the value at the last iteration, so 2.5% in each direction. So the two segments delimit a tube and they become green when the blue line stays inside the tube. The algorithm stops when all the tubes are green. In other words, it stops when, for all parameters, the average and standard deviations of the conditional means computed during the last 50 iterations do not deviate by more than 5% from the values computed at the last iteration. Among all samples from the conditional distribution drawn by the algorithm, a small number is kept to be used in the plot and for the statistical test. This number is defined in the last setting, simulated parameters per individual. The default number is usually 10, but it can be reduced by Monolix for large datasets to avoid having an unnecessarily large number of dots in the plot. The 10 samples chosen to be used in the plot are evenly spread across all the iterations of the algorithm. This avoids keeping samples from consecutive iterations, which could be correlated. Once the task has run, the in-diff param section of the results tab contains the estimated conditional mean for each individual, as well as a summary for all individuals. In the result folder, the files simulated individual parameters and simulated random effects contain the parameters that have been selected to be used in the plot. So here, 10 replicates for each individual. All this information is also available on our online documentation. See you next week.